have a seat. Well, it's a great joy to welcome you all to St. Stephen Walbrook this evening, the parish church of Sir Christopher Wren, for this service which marks the start of our special season of anniversaries. On behalf of all of us, I'm delighted to welcome Bishop Nicholas as our preacher, an author, broadcaster, and former Bishop of Salisbury, and also known to many of you through his ministry in London as Vicar of St Martin-in-the-Fields, and prior to that in the Isle of Dogs and in Stepney, where he worked with a young novice verger called Lee Fitzgerald. Many stories to be told, I'm sure. I'm thrilled that this evening we have the privilege of guests representing many of the key phases of the history of St. Stephen Walbrook. The master grocer and members of the worshipful company of grocers, patrons of this church, built on land given in 1428 by Sir Robert Chicherley, master grocer and twice Lord Mayor. Lord Palumbo, church warden for over 30 years and great friend of Chad Varra, and who along with Chad orchestrated the crucial restoration of this church and the reordering around this ever fabulous Henry Moore altar. Felicity Harding, devoted ambassador and supporter of the Samaritans, founded by her father, Chad, 70 years ago this November. And we have a Wren expert in our midst, and representing a new generation of passionate St. Stephen Walbrook enthusiasts, Luca Padjevic, who has kindly provided illustrations for the order of service, and who has also kindly agreed to offer his reflections as a doctoral student of Wren on the church. We're also very pleased that Mother Kate, Vicar of St. Mark's, Hamilton Terrace, and her husband are with us this evening, as this community in the 17th century, the community of St. Mark's, is in the process of rebuilding following destruction of their church by fire in January. I do very much hope that you enjoy this service of celebration. All you need is in the order of service, and I now invite Luca to speak to us.
An occasion such as this reminds us, first of all, of how fortunate we are to have a building with such a rich and well-preserved historical record. That it was begun in December 1672, 6 years after it had burned down to the ground, was personally supervised by Wren and completed at a cost of £7,692 by the end of 1679, are all uncontested facts, borne out by the archives and by the building itself. Similarly uncontroversial and oft repeated is the opinion that it is the most architecturally accomplished of Wren's city churches, with a plan which ingeniously reconciles the longitudinal thrust of a traditional nave with the vertical centralizing force of a large dome. However, despite the clarity of the historical record and the profusion of architectural commentary over the intervening centuries, its significance as a church, that is, an architectural vessel for Christian worship, has rarely been acknowledged. The general tendency, exemplified by Sir John Summerson, has been to view St. Stephen's as a work of geometric genius, which only happens to be a church. A study in architectural logic, as he put it, whose architecture resolves itself like a Euclidean theorem with extraordinary simplicity and grace. Or in the words of Professor Kerry Downes, a work of geometry mysterious and magical, accessible to the worshipper and the agnostic. In this view, the communion table, the tall pulpit, and the box pews which originally occupied most of its broad land are held to be the only specifically Christian elements of St. Stephen's.
Meanwhile, its generic ornament and crisp classical detailing seem to provide little warrant for specifically Christian reading.
Apologies for that, I should have stopped. Why should I? All right. So, I don't know how much of that you've heard, but I was quickly explaining how, in the view of most architectural historians, the essential Christian fittings of the communion table, pulpit, and box pews, which originally occupied most of the church floor, are typically seen as inessential. And when faced with the fabric itself, the crisp classical detailing and the ornamental plaster work, most have come to the conclusion that there's nothing essentially Christian about its iconography. What I would like to do today is share several meditations on the religious topography of Wren's design, which I firmly believe would have been legible to the believers of his day, as I hope it will be today. Some of it quite speculative, but hopefully prayerful and helpful. Perhaps the best place to start our journey is by reimagining the impact of this interior at the time of its completion. Ascending the steep stairs from the bustle of Walbrook, the visitor would have found himself standing in a dark sea of 5-foot-high box pews with but a single unencumbered aisle running down the middle to the east end. Taking his seat in one of the box pews, which obstructed one's view of the church floor, column bases, and most of the congregation, his gaze would have been inexorably drawn upwards to the light-filled dome. As today, the dome with its luminous lantern would have dominated the impression, drawing our first glance and remaining ever-present as the eye begins to wander. I am reminded here of the Byzantine historian Procopius, who upon seeing the newly completed dome of the Hagia Sophia in 544, described it as appearing not to be founded on solid masonry, but suspended from heaven by a golden chain. A similar suspension of belief is called upon at St. Stephen's, whose architecture, like that of the Hagia Sophia, is essentially a hanging architecture, its vaults depending from above without any apparent weight of their own. I think the brass chandeliers help that impression somewhat. Now, as our gaze begins to cascade down the coffered surface of the dome and across the pendant cornice, it finally settles on the 8 richly decorated arches which form a sort of inverted crown, so you see that right under the dome, round the main space. The principal 4 open up to receive the cruciform vaults of the nave and transepts, while the remaining 4 on the diagonal open onto Clare Street squinches. As one's eye takes in this profusion of vaulted forms, one excrescence at a time, the mind is called to that house of many mansions, which the Gospel of St. John promises to all believers. Within this suspended landscape, the four light-filled corners, what I previously referred to as squinches on the diagonal, stand out as points of almost unbearable concentration. It is in their sail-like surfaces that the effigies of the 4 evangelists are usually to be found emblazoned in most continental churches of a similar type, as Wren would have known well. Next in this descending hierarchy, so right under Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, invisible in this case, our eye settles on the 4 columnar triplets found beneath each squinch. These in turn form a palisade of 12 evenly spaced columns whose significance, whether tribal or apostolic, could hardly have escaped Wren's contemporaries. These columns also demarcate a line beyond which magnificent vaults of the central space give way to something more domestic, the flat ceilings around the perimeter. However, one never loses sight of the center as the eye flits back and forth from the relative darkness of the flat-sealed perimeter through a screen of 12 columns to the apparently weightless landscape of efflorescent vaults crowned by the dome. That such a compelling yet gentle sense of upward movement, of religious drama without histrionics, could have been created over a relatively simple ground plan is perhaps St. Stephen's chief glory. As far as I'm concerned, this is heaven in a box. A man-made microcosm on par with the heavenly visions of Dionysius the Areopagite. However, despite all of this, St. Stephen's is not an easy work to penetrate. Unlike so many churches before or since, it demands our attention without giving us an easy way in. No picturesque layers, no stain of time, no comforting imagery, nothing indeed but the heavenly hierarchies englobed in white painted plaster and flooded with unadulterated light. Still, it is by no means overwhelming. What it seems to do is make one's mind completely alert while putting one's body at ease. That is what sets it apart as not only a work of genius, but of grace, and indeed a worthy object of contemplation. For to contemplate, in its original Latin sense, means to gaze upon a sacred precinct, a sacred ground, with one's attention undivided, in wait for mysteries not so readily given to us in the daily rhythm of life. And I think St. Stephen's does that beautifully.
Thank you very much, Luca. Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, who has taught us that all our doings without charity are nothing worth, send thy Holy Ghost and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of charity, the very bond of peace and of all virtues, without which whosoever liveth is counted dead before thee. Grant this for thine only Son, Jesus Christ's sake. Amen.
You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But now, in Christ Jesus, you, who once were far off, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one, and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, so that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel is written in the fifth chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew, beginning at the 13th verse.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Isn't it? I bet they didn't trouble about this in Wednesday. As Lucas said, by common consent, St. Stephen's Walbrook is Wren's greatest church in that extraordinary achievement, building 51 churches as well as St. Paul's Cathedral after the Great Fire. In last Sunday's, I thought, brilliant broadcast on Radio 4 last Sunday, Neil McGregor described Wren's buildings as the built counterpart to the Book of Common Prayer, published in 1662, just 4 years before the fire. Wren's task, Neil said, was not just the physical rebuilding after the fire, but the much greater spiritual one of rebuilding the church after the Civil War. Taken together, the city churches are a liturgical language, enabling the greatest possible number of citizens to feel comfortable in their address to God, he said. And as we observe, these churches, this church, is a place where everyone can see everything with clear glass and natural daylight, as it were the light of heaven, illuminating the interior and allowing a connection with the world outside. Our church buildings point beyond themselves to God and earthing heaven. They represent something within the city, proclaiming the things of God to the people at work and leisure, the paroikoi, the parish, those gathered around the house. A church in the city declares its belief in the God of love as concerned with the way we make wealth as how we use it. And the ability to make wealth depends on creativity and on the integrity of our relationships and trust in one another. Indeed, wealth creation is destroyed by the absence of truth and justice. The primary purpose of the city is of wealth creation, not only in an economic sense, but in terms of our well-being, the commonwealth. Working in this huge concentration of resource and power, we need an honest commitment to one another, as well as to individual gain. Traditionally, this was established through face-to-face dealing and trust, that I'm as good as my word. That's much more complex to achieve now, particularly with so much done in a virtual world, but it's no less important. Churches in the city remind everyone of the ways of God amidst the temptations of mammon, that they were built in part with the aid of the coal tax, and indeed that Henry Moore was the son of a Yorkshire miner, ought to remind us today of our responsibilities represented by the government's levelling up agenda. The history of developing global markets points to uncomfortable responsibilities in relation to our doing well, sometimes at the expense of others. And now we must add the environmental responsibilities to work quickly towards becoming net zero no later than by 2050. You are the salt of the earth, the light of the world. That's such an important calling for us to aspire to. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltness be restored? Not so many people come to church nowadays. Fewer than half the UK's population say they're Christian. Church is seen by many as a toxic brand because we've claimed exemption from equalities legislation and responded so poorly to the changing patterns of sex, gender, and relationships. If God is anywhere, God is everywhere. Those of us who believe in God can, of course, worship God anywhere. Yet the reality is that an inspiring mountain view or walk by the sea doesn't do enough for the community. We need particular places that are holy, set apart. Even though we know our church buildings are ambiguous places. Simon Jenkins says our churches are the museums of England. We'll have a sense of that tonight. But they're so much more than that as places of worship. We learn the habits of the Christian life as we learn so much else by imitation, repetition, and practice. It takes place in the home as well as at church and school. It's easier to pray in a place where others pray and learn the disciplines of the Christian life in ways that will be emphasized in the days of Lent by self-examination and repentance, prayer, fasting, self-denial, by reading and meditating on the scriptures, by generosity and charity. Learning these disciplines, really learning them, making sure you get them inside yourself, that they become interior, sets us free to innovate and improvise and be creative for our own and the common good. But I don't think the church does this just as an internal activity. We learn it in our engagement with the wider world. Here at St. Stephen's, that engagement's represented with the business community, not just by them helping to pay for an expensive adornment, but in seeking good values and moral purpose in the best we can offer to God through our work. We can hear and see that engagement in the architecture and in the arts, especially in music and this altar. Before he became chair of the Arts Advisory Panel at St. Martin-in-the-Fields, Nicholas Goodison commented that good art creates controversy. as part of the church's engagement, he wanted me to know that we were, he wanted me to say that we were willing to work with that, because it's a way in which we can engage with the world around us, much as you've had to do here in relation to this Henry Moore altar. Get the relationship between church and world right, and a sort of magic happens, as it did with the somewhat angular Chadvara setting up the Samaritans, and the church meeting a whole new group of people coming in who helped it rediscover what it is to be the salt and light for the world. England is the founding charism of the Church of England. We can't really invent an ecclesiology that makes any sense anywhere else. It is the Church of England, and it takes a bit of working out. Formed out of the Henrican Reformation and Elizabethan settlement, it's lived with the unpleasant certainties and ill behaviour of the Civil War, and had periods in which the beauty of holiness has engendered astonishing creativity, charity, and civility. It's responded pastorally to the traumas of the fire and the blitz, of terrorist bombings and violent stabbings. Church has its place. In Philip Larkin's poem, Church Going, he approaches with a skepticism that wonders whether churches have had their day and whether they'll survive. Yet at the end, it pleases me to stand in silence here. A serious house on serious earth it is, in whose blent air all our compulsions meet, are recognized and robed as destinies. And that much never can be obsolete, since someone will forever be surprising, a hungering himself to be more serious, and gravitating with it to this ground, which he once heard was proper to grow wise in, if only that so many dead lie round. In the anniversaries we celebrate tonight, we remember the dead and give thanks to them, and give thanks for them in a faith that began at an empty tomb and gives life still. Big anniversaries are opportunities to give thanks, seek forgiveness, and set a direction. To rediscover what it might mean to be the salt of the earth and light of the world. It seemed like that, a church with a history has a future. Amen.
Thank you. Whether we're here for the first time or the 500th time, we're all part of one community, past, present, and future. So let us join with this great cloud of witnesses in prayer to Almighty God. As we gather in the brightness of this beautiful church, may the light of Christ purify our hearts. Bless all who have ministered here in his name. By their teaching and example, may the radiance of your love shine through our thoughts, words, and deeds. Remembering especially this night, all those whom we love but see no longer. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
As we contemplate Wren's dome above, may your creative spirit flourish in all life below. We give thanks for those who designed, constructed, and restored this church. May they inspire each of us to fashion our lives harmoniously. Remembering especially this night all those displaced through violence and climate change. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
As we celebrate this milestone in our history, may we, your living stones, be enlivened by the joy of your presence among us. Bless all who call this place home. Remembering this night our patrons, our staff and supporters, singers, organists, trumpeters, married couples, those who mourn, history buffs, city workers, jazz bands, chamber quartets, tourists and their guides, photographers, yoga teachers, events managers, carol singers, church watchers, the people who look after our microphones, and the occasional dog. Every one of you who seasoned this sacred space with the spice of life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, and forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God,
Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and singing. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father. We most humbly beseech thee and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. In the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Now, as our Saviour Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood which was shed for you. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who duly receive these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen. Well, many thanks indeed to all of you for your wonderful support this evening, and a particular thanks to Bishop Nick, to Luca, and to our wonderful musicians. If you're interested in singing, do come along on Wednesday lunchtimes at 1 o'clock and join our fabulous community choir. It's a joy to sing. It's good for the heart and soul, particularly in the middle of the working day. Do stay for the reception and return to St. Stephen Walbrook as soon as you are able. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.